Hi, I'm Kate Fessler. I'm a graduate student here at the University of Minnesota in the Applied Plant Sciences program. I'm housed within the Department of Horticulture. And my master's thesis research is on assessing a tabletop strawberry growing system for Minnesota's climate. So this is our tabletop system. As you can see, it's not actually a table. It's just set at table height. And that makes it a really wonderful and efficient system for growing because it's very easy on your back when you're harvesting. And it uses a soilless media, and that really reduces a lot of the common issues that people have with growing strawberries, which are soil-borne pests and diseases primarily, as well as some predation from, you know, rodents, bugs, etc. They can't overwinter in the soil when they're in the soilless media system that's elevated like this. And so you can generally get higher yields. You can get nice big fruit that's high quality, usually a lot cleaner than you would get when you were growing in the ground traditionally. What you see here is the strawberry plants planted into their soilless media, and the soilless media and the plants are all set in these black plastic troughs that are right here. Those troughs are then set into this steel gutter underneath, this kind of white part, and they're supported by the poles underneath. So that's what kind of forms the backbone of the structure. These brackets right here are truss tape supports. You can also use them though to suspend the system from a high tunnel or from a greenhouse ceiling if that's something you're interested in, because they have these nice hooks. You can kind of hook something or latch it, or I've actually seen people use twine or something kind of strong like that. But they support this truss tape so that when the berries actually begin to form and they're getting really heavy, the trusses can actually lean over the tape, and that way they don't break on the sides of the plastic trough. What you can also see here is the main header line. So you manually punch holes in this header line with, I think, a 5/8 size drill bit, and then you pop these little spaghetti tubes in, and these are your emitters. So this line runs all the way up and is attached to one of these little guys, and the water drips out of this hole down through here and then into the soil or into the media. Down here you can see, you know, this system, the gutter comes up to me maybe like hip height, but at the other end of the system it comes up almost to chest height, and that's really important because this is the end of the system. All of the remaining nutrient solution and water drips out of and is collected in this bucket. So we have, you know, a couple percent slope that we've created here to make sure that all of that, you know, excess water and nutrients drips out the bottom and actually drains properly. You don't ever want, you know, your troughs to be swimming in excess solution or anything like that. And in order to do that, we really just did a 1/4 inch drop on each of the poles as we progressed down the line when we were driving them. It's a really easy way to make sure that you're actually creating that slope when you install the system. So you'll see that the plants that are here are actually spaced much more tightly than they would be in the field. That is because we're trying to sort of maximize yield in this system. So you'll find that even though they're planted more densely and you might get a slightly lower yield per plant in this system, you do get a much higher yield overall considering the amount of space that you're using. And because the plants aren't terribly expensive individually, that trade-off is worth it in terms of the overall gains. At the very least, that's kind of what has been found in other places, and that's one of the things that we're measuring here, and we're trying to see whether it proves true for Minnesota as well. So the two varieties that we're testing here are Cabrillo and Albion. So you can see they don't look terribly different. They're both day-neutral varieties, which means they're going to flower fruit all season, from hopefully about July until into October or November, depending on when we get a really good hard freeze. These two were selected because of the quality of the fruit. So Albion is an older variety. from UC Davis that we know produces really sweet fruit. People really love the flavor. It's very high quality. It is not the most high yielding variety out there, but the Cabrillo has consistently really high yields. It's a newer variety from UC Davis, and it is supposed to also have really excellent fruit quality. So we're really growing it for the first time at the University of Minnesota, and based on the results from our trial season last season, we found that it did really well, so we're excited to try it again this season. And it's supposed to have pretty large, firm fruit, so a really good post-harvest shelf life, for instance, which will make it easier for farmers, ideally, to, you know, get it to the farmer's market without having to worry as much. And it is also supposed to have pretty good fruit quality, so it is supposed to have a really nice flavor overall. So we are trialing two varieties of strawberry plants, but we're also trialing two different media types this year. So they are the Berger OM6 and the Berger BM4. We thus far have not found a difference in yield between the two media based on our pilot season last season, but we are going to be continuing to take a look at that this upcoming season. That can be potentially a good option for you depending on whether you try to use organic practices, you know, or whether you're looking for something that is conventional that you know is reliable already and you feel comfortable with. This is called a Tensiometer. I believe that the, you know, actual brand name for this one is Aerometer. And so this is essentially something that measures the moisture down in the root zone. So it helps guide me when I'm trying to decide when I want to water. There are, you know, more sophisticated systems that you can attach to a timer and they can, you know, trigger your fertilization system automatically. But this one I just read by sight. So for instance, right now I haven't watered yet. It's reading a 4. A 0 would be that the media is completely saturated, doesn't need any water, and it goes all the way up to 40, which is completely dry. And so based on that reading, I know that it could use a little bit of water, but maybe the system only needs to run for about 5 minutes today, as opposed to 10 or 20 minutes if it were hotter and drier out today. This is our fertigation board. This is where our water comes in, mixes with our stock concentration, which is a really concentrated fertilizer solution, and then goes out through our main header line, through our emitters, into the actual troughs to water the berries. So what we have here is we have a hose that's hooked up to this valve. The water runs up through here, comes through, the pressure is actually measured right here, so here's our pressure gauge. And then at this point, it can either be diverted down through these valves into the mixrite injector, which uses the water pressure to draw our stock concentration solution up through the tube. It then mixes and heads out that way, comes up here, and then comes down these lines to come into the actual irrigation main header line. There are two here. We're only using one line, but if you wanted to run two header lines, you could also run one down the other side of the system if you want to double it for some reason. We also have this line. So if, for instance, I was looking to flush the system, obviously fertilizer has a lot of salts in it. Sometimes there are issues with pH or something like that. If you wanted to water with just plain water, you would turn these valves to this position, so you turn them off so that the water doesn't divert down through the mixrite injector, and you turn this one on. And so that makes it so that the water comes up through the hose and just shoots straight through this pipe and into the main header line. So something that's really important here is that we have a little hose screen stuck into the screen to make sure that any particulate matter can't come up through our main, you know, irrigation line and wind up clogging, for instance, any of the emitters. It is good, you know, if you realize that you have a decrease in flow, it can be good to take a look and make sure that there's nothing caught here. So these will need to be cleaned every once in a while. That's just a little bit of a troubleshooting thing. But we have our hose hooked up here. Goes into our main irrigation line. And then when you turn it on, you can actually start to hear, I don't know if you can hear it right now, but you can start to hear the clicking of the mixed-right injector as it's drawing the solution up out of the bucket and sending it through the lines. And then you can start to hear and see actually, you know, all of the little spaghetti tubes kind of start to jump as the water moves through them, and you can tell that they're actually starting to water properly. So, as I mentioned before, this is the pressure gauge. And the pressure gauge is important because you do need to have enough water pressure for your, you know, water to actually make it all the way through your system. It's losing pressure the whole time because of the drag coming through the hose, coming through all the pipes, heading through the line. The mixed-right injector really doesn't need as high water pressure as you think. I had a hard time finding the exact information, but essentially anywhere between like 30 and 120 PSI is okay for it. We're running our system at between 60 and 70 PSI, and that's a little bit of a personal thing because when it gets anywhere higher, you know, into the 80s or the 90s, the end cap on the end of the header line sometimes pops off. We are using a 100-foot hose. Mixed-right doesn't actually recommend that you use anything longer than a 50-foot hose, but because this is an experiment, like an experiment station, we have unusually high water pressure. So that's something to be aware of, whether or not you personally have decent water pressure or not. That can affect, you know, how well you're going to actually be able to move water through the system. So we are watering at the moment about 5 to 10 minutes a day, every day. We are going based on the moisture of the media. So like I mentioned earlier, I use the tensiometers that give me an idea of what the moisture is like in the root zone. And that can kind of tell me, you know, is it at a 5, which is a little bit drier. And if it's at a 5, maybe I'll run it for 8 to 10 minutes. If I can tell that it's pretty moist, the tensiometer is only reading maybe a 1, I might run it for closer to 5 minutes because I still want to give them nutrients that day, but I don't want to totally waterlog the system. It is important though to never let your media actually dry out because that's when you start to have bigger problems with salinity. In a system like this, salinity from the fertilizer solution can build up in the media. And it's important for the media to always be at a constant moisture to prevent any water loss from the plants. You know, it's kind of that fun osmosis we all learned about in high school where the salts will start drawing water out of the plants if there isn't enough water moistening the root zone. So we are probably using not an insane amount of water actually to water just because we are trying to water consistently every single day. But as the summer gets hotter and longer, you know, as we have less rain, because we've had a really rainy last couple of weeks, I might start fertigating twice a day. There are some farmers I know who, you know, fertilize 7 times a day, but they do it in really short bursts for just a minute or two at a time, kind of spaced evenly throughout the day. We have found that at least, you know, during our trial season last year, fertilizing once a day was perfectly adequate for us. And then we will flush the whole thing with plain tap water. So just water with plain tap water over the weekends to just kind of clear some of that salt, some of the excess nutrients out and give them a fresh start on Monday. I use a pH and EC meter. So I measure about 3 times a week the acidity and salinity of the solution that comes out the other end of the system, to give me an idea of what's going on in the root zone and what kind of nutrition the plants are actually receiving. So what I'm holding here is my pH-EC meter. So it just measures the acidity and the salinity of a liquid that I stick my probes into. And I have two different probes. So this one is my pH probe. So this tells me how acidic the root zone around my strawberry plants is. They prefer an acidity of between 5.5 to 6.5. And any higher than that, they start to have problems with being able to access all the nutrients that they need. So I just dip it into the bucket, into this kind of excess solution that came out of the system. And then I wait for this guy to stop changing, and it will, you know, tell me where my acidity is at. So right now it's actually a little bit high. It's a little higher than it has been. You know, you can also test the pH of the nutrient solution that goes in. So my stock concentration is actually at about a 3, which is pretty acidic. I wouldn't stick your hand in there if I were you. But you can see that by the time it mixes with my source water and passes through, I'm about a 6.9. So that's not, you know, so high that it's really going to hurt the strawberry plants or anything like that, but it's something to be aware of, because if it gets, you know, any higher, I might want to start amending my nutrient solution with a little bit of sulfuric acid, for instance. So then I can move on and use my probe that measures the salts. And this is on, you know, a different scale from the pH. So my nutrient solution down at the other end that is really concentrated, it's 100 times concentrated, that salinity, it's at like a 6, which is insanely high. But down here, it is at a 1.6. So that's actually okay. Anywhere between 1.5 and 2 is a little bit high. But it's only kind of when you get up into about 2, if your plants are starting to look unhealthy, that you want to, you know, start taking some action. So for instance, you want to start flushing your system with clean water to bring that salinity, so essentially the amount of salt built up in the media, down a little bit. So on day neutral strawberries, we actually remove the flowers for the first month or so after they break dormancy. So these guys were planted first week of May, toward the end of the first week of May. And so probably until about mid-June, we're going to remove the first flush of flowers. And that is so that the plants have enough time to kind of put on all their leaves to get lots of vegetative growth so that they can be healthy throughout the entire season. We will also be removing runners throughout the season. We don't have too many of them at the moment. The ones that are growing are quite small. But unlike June-bearing strawberries, we really do want to remove those because we're not looking to let these plants get really established and put out all their daughter plants. It's not as much of an issue with day neutrals though, because they don't grow exactly the same as June-bearing strawberries. So they don't produce as many runners to begin with. If you were going to try to de-runner June-bearing strawberries, you would have no reason to, but you would have a pretty big job of work to try to keep up with them. So that's really not as bad with the day neutrals, but we do remove those runners as well. And although we remove the flowers for just, you know, the first 6 weeks or so, we do remove the runners throughout the season as they appear.